but sometimes I choose to live my days without you, going through the motions of my life. But then I remember times when I was near you, all those precious moments you were close to me. And I'd be such a fool to stay away from you. Nothing in this world compares to you. My father and my friend who cares for me. And I want to spend eternity with you.
Good morning, everyone. It's really great to be here again with you all, even though it's a virtual reality because we're only connecting via a screen. But as I said last time, and as many people have said, the Holy Spirit can come and invade this space of time. He is present with us. He hasn't gone away. And so he can make this thing live, even though, as you can see, and as you know, it is a recording. But we're going to share this recording together now, and so have a kind of corporate experience together. Remember to make comments. even if it's just to announce that you're there and say good morning, because that's really helpful. We get a feeling for who's around. And remember that you've got the link at the bottom if you want to connect up for private prayer, and somebody will respond to you on that link. And afterwards we have the Zoom meeting, which I really encourage more of you to connect with that. The link and the password and stuff will be there at the bottom at the end again this morning. So do try and connect with that, because it's kind of fun. We have a little bit of chat, a little good humoured banter, but we also maybe talk about things that come up in the morning for people and how that's impacted them and so on. So just remember, it's a great time, it's great fun, and I think, you know, just remember to join in. I'll remind you again at the end, but the Zoom meeting, just get on there if you can. As you can see, I'm recording this from what passes for being an office. It's actually a corridor between our bedroom and the bathroom, and I'll keep the bathroom door closed because you may not want to hear any strange sounds emanating from that direction. But here we are, and you can see my cards up there, which give you a flavour of things that I feel are important. There's one that says God with us, there's another says the joy of the Lord is the strength. But there's one that I really like there, those two dogs that you can just see up the top there. And one dog is saying to the other, how do you make a cat flap? And the other dog replies, throw him off a cliff. Well, that might amuse some of you, but it kind of amuses me. So that still has pride of place up there as well, with the other cards, similarly profound thoughts. So, okay, without more ado, let's just move to this. We've got a little contribution here from Lucy. Our mum's interviewing her, and she's just talking about her reactions to being in this lockdown situation. And I think you'll find it's just fun to see through her eyes. So let's go right over to Lucy now.
Okay. Lucy, what have you enjoyed about lockdown?
I've enjoyed that I can play games like Kaplunk, Ludo and Simon and the Game of Life. But I've mainly just done the Game of Life on Ludo with my mummy and daddy.
What else have you enjoyed?
And that me and mummy get to go in the swimming pool even if daddy didn't come in. And I get to go on the trampoline and do awesome tricks.
How are you at going to sleep and getting up? Are you good?
No, not really.
Why?
Because I mostly go to bed late, so I wake up late.
Okay. And have you spoken to anybody, your grandparents or anybody, over the lockdown?
Yeah, I've spoken to my nanny, granddad, and my aunties and uncles.
Okay, and how did you do that?
I do it on Zoom.
Okay, and did we have a party for Nanny as well?
Yeah, we had a party for Nanny.
On Zoom.
On Zoom, and I got to eat off all the biscuits and sometimes drink off all the fizz.
And what sort of a cake did you make for Nanny's birthday? With a candle in it. What did we use?
We used a butternut squash.
A butternut squash, that's right, we did. Have you spoken to anybody else, any teachers on Zoom?
I've spoken to my flute teacher called Mrs. Player.
And she gives you lessons, doesn't she?
Yeah.
And any friends?
I've spoken to my best friend, Tandy.
Wonderful. Lucy, what don't you like about lockdown?
That I'm getting taken away from all my friends.
Okay. What about some trips that you were due to go on? Did you have some school trips or anything you were due to go on? What happened to them?
I was supposed to go on brownies. I was supposed to go on
to a camp.
Like a type of camp that we go on. Like I did last year.
And that was cancelled?
This time was cancelled. But we're going to do it maybe after September.
Okay. Who else do you miss?
I miss my best friend Tandy, who I might I just might not be able to see her tonight. I will be able to see her this year.
What about your teachers? You missing any of your teachers at school?
My normal teacher, Miss Sitcom.
What about Sunday school? Do you miss Sunday school?
Yeah.
Have you been going to any special classes?
Yes, I've gone to something called The Bubble, where children of key workers go to get their education. They have no choice but to go.
Why?
I don't know.
Okay, because their parents have to go to work. Okay. What are you looking forward to after the lockdown, Lucy?
I'm looking forward to going to Butlins with two of my best friends.
Lovely.
Two of my friends.
And also, what about visiting relatives? Are you looking forward to seeing any of those?
Yeah.
Who in particular? Anyone in particular looking forward to seeing?
No.
No? Okay, just everybody.
Except for Michael. I can't wait to fight with him.
He's your cousin. Okay, thank you very much, Lucy.
That was really great, Lucy. Thanks for that. And we're just going to pray for you. I think we'll pray for you together and other children who are in the same situation as you. We just pray, Lord, that you will bless these children, that they won't have missed out, that you will make up to them everything they might have lost during this time, and they will catch up and they'll be able to do all the things in their heart to do. We just pray that you'll bless them and just bless them, Lord, just bless them. And thank you for the good times they've been able to have during lockdown as well. We just want to give you thanks for that as well, Lord, because some of the times have been good as well. And so we just thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, before we go over to our worship time, which I know you're going to enjoy, Emma's leading it and she's accompanied by Richard, I think, on keyboards. We're going to have a good time there. But just before we do that, I want to pray a prayer over us all as God's people right now at this moment. But I want to use the words of Paul's prayer over 2,000 years ago that he prayed for the early believers, but which I believe is a valid prayer and the prayer that we should be praying over one another and praying, you know, forgive me if I'm repeating myself, I've done this before other times, but this is so, to me, is so important that we can pray these prayers over ourselves and say yes and amen with Paul back there. We're connected, you know, in an unseen way with the hosts of people, believers who've gone before us, that somehow there's a living entity somehow involving Father, Son and Holy Spirit and the angels and the people we can't see who've already gone ahead of us in glory, who are joining together right now with us and the angels in this moment to praise and worship God together. And the prayers that were prayed have not been lost, not gone into some big pit somewhere and just, oh, that was nice. But they're remembered in heaven. And this prayer that Paul prayed is a prayer that I can't improve on. It was my prayer for you and my prayer for ourselves. And he says, he prays like this, and I'm praying it now over you. I pray that the Father of glory, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, will impart to you, the riches of the Spirit of wisdom, the Holy Spirit of wisdom, and the Holy Spirit of revelation, to know him, to really know him through your deepening intimacy with him, with the Holy Spirit, and with the Father, and with the Son. And I pray that the light of God will light up the eyes of your imagination, flooding you with light, until you experience the full revealing of the hope of his calling. That is the wealth of God's glorious inheritances that he finds in us, his holy ones, his people. I pray that you will continually experience the immeasurable greatness of God's power made available to you through faith. Then your lives will be an advertisement of this immense power as it works through you. This is the mighty power. This is the mighty power that was released when God raised Jesus, the Anointed One, from the dead and exalted him to the place of highest honour and supreme authority in the heavenly realm. And now he is exalted as first above every ruler, authority, government and realm of power in existence. He is gloriously enthroned over every name that is ever praised, not only in this age, but in the age that is coming. And he alone is the leader and source of everything needed in the church. That's us. God has put everything beneath the authority of Jesus Christ and has given him the highest rank above all others. And now we, his church, are his body on earth and that which fills him who is being filled by. Amen. 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 So let's go right over into a time of worship, or at least let's say an aspect of worship that involves singing and declaring things out to God. Let's go over. Thank you, Emma. Just lead us into that time now. Thank you.
Right, good morning, church. It's great to have you again with me. Haven't seen my face for a little while doing worship, at least. I just want to pray for this morning. I pray, Father, that we just get to really experience you this morning, Lord, and all your love, because you care for us so deeply. You love us so deeply, Lord. And I pray that your presence just fill our homes right now and we just get a real sense of that love. Amen. Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like the covenant of old. You are making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride. Faithful you have been, faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing your praise.
Praise, you will be praised with
praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Lord, I just thank you, Father, that your love just makes us want to sing, Father. That we can't help but just sing your praises, Lord. And you are just amazing. Everything that you do is amazing, Lord. It's overwhelming, Father. And Lord, thank you that we can praise you because of who you are, Lord. Cross, forgiven and free, forever you'll just want us to join with the angels now. Let's really declare that bridge. You know, you are beautiful, Lord. You're wonderful. You're glorious. Let's join with them now and just sing that again, because I think there's something powerful when we come with the angels and they're declaring the same thing as us. So yeah, let's do that. You are beautiful, you are beautiful, oh God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful, you are wonderful, oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful, God, you are the most wonderful. You are glorious, you are glorious, oh God.
Faithful, faithful, forever you will be. Faithful.
and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Faithful, forever you will be. Faithful, you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. In your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. And again, all your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Amen. Have a great Sunday, guys. Bye.
Thank you very much, Emma. That was amazing, brilliant. Just that incredible focus on the Lord himself. You know, he is faithful. We're captivated by him. And all his promises are yes and amen. He is faithful. Again, repeated in that song. All your promises are yes and amen. And I think that's a song that Alan wanted, that all your promises are yes and amen, as a kind of a setup for the talk that he's now going to give you. So let's go over to Alan right now and hear what he's got to say to us this morning. Thank you, Alan.
Good morning. Faithful you are. Faithful you ever will be. Faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. That's a great song for us to be singing at a time like this, when we are living in such uncertainty. I've actually found that song to be quite a challenge to me just recently, and I'd like to share with you why. You see, for some time, I've been grappling with the promises that Jesus made during his earthly mission. Let me explain to you why. At the beginning of his earthly mission, Jesus declared what his mission parameters were. In Luke 4, verses 18 to 19, it is recorded that Jesus said this: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Now that's quite a mission statement, but Jesus told his listeners that this day, that scripture had been fulfilled in their ears. And then it's also recorded in John chapter 19, verse 30, that Jesus' final words from the cross were, "It is finished." Now, you may know that John's Gospel was written in Greek. The word that was used for the phrase, "It is finished," is tetelestai, which literally means finished, accomplished, completed, paid. In fact, I've been told by a native Greek speaker that you can still hear the word being used at the end of a transaction in Greek markets. But we also know that Jesus' language was not actually Greek, but Aramaic and Hebrew. In these languages, the same phrase means repaid, restored to the uttermost, fulfilled, redeemed, revived. In other words, job done. Added to this, we are further told by Paul in Ephesians 1, verse 19 to 22, that his mighty power raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world but in the age to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. Wow. Not only that, but the next chapter, Ephesians 2, verse 6, tells us that we have been raised up and made to sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Jesus has finished his mission. He has brought us to the position where we can rest in his completed work, seated with him. It's not a partial completion, but it's the whole deal. In other words, it's done. A few weeks ago, in his excellent presentation, Matt clearly shared with us that the word sozo means so much more than just saved. I agree with everything he says. But at the same time, I would like to add that I see the word sozo as encompassing everything that Jesus not only did, but also the things that he said when he was on earth. And that includes his promises to us. Those promises include such things as abundant life, his peace, a miraculous lifestyle, freedom, amongst them many other things. From my personal observation, I have found that sometimes we seem to be able to live in the good of our eternal salvation, but we find that those promises seem to elude us. We often make bold statements that we possess these promises in our songs, but really we have little experience of them in our lives. It is as though our songs declare the things that we know to be true, and therefore we aspire to them, and yet fail to appropriate them. Maybe we consider them to be things which are unattainable for us, and that it will always be a process of growth. Let's just consider the question of freedom. We tend to think of freedom as being free from something. For example, we talk about it in terms of being free from sin, free from the penalty of a death, free from torment, free from being separated from God. I've not often heard it talked about our freedom to do things. For example, the freedom to make choices, the freedom to pursue a calling, the freedom to follow a career, the freedom to have a family or not to have a family. It's up to us. One thing that we often don't recognise is the fact that we have the freedom to do right or wrong. God really does love us. That's how much the freedom extends to us. We don't often think about freedom in these sorts of terms. And yet, freedom is much more all-encompassing. I grew up listening to the speeches of people like Martin Luther King. I actually grew up sort of becoming overawed by the things that the people were saying about freedom. Those of you who've watched films like Braveheart will actually know that when people make speeches about freedom, it rouses something inside somebody. They want to be free. During the Second World War, it was the speeches of people like Sir Winston Churchill, which turned the heart of the people in this country from the defeat of D-Day to the victory, sorry, the defeat of Dunkirk to the victory of D-Day. Freedom is something which is really important to us. Let's just consider that for a moment. Jesus made a promise, many promises about freedom. Listen to this. In John chapter 8, verse 32, it says this, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Then a few verses later, Jesus stresses the point. "Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you are free indeed." That's incredible. We sing that, and yet do we actually experience it? Do we live in that sort of freedom? Look at what Paul says about freedom. This is taken from Galatians chapter 5, verse 1 in the Passion Translation. "Let me be clear. The Anointed One has set us free, not partially, but completely and wonderfully free. We must always cherish this truth and stubbornly refuse to go back into the bondage of our past." That's quite a statement. It's as though Paul is saying, look, even though we experience a mismatch between what we believe and what we experience, we must never let go of clinging to that particular promise and seeking it for ourselves. Now, how does the mismatch occur? Well, I've thought long and hard about this, and I've come to the conclusion that it can be described by the fact that we have an enemy who wants nothing more than to steal, kill, and destroy the blessings that Jesus has won for us. He will lie, cheat, deceive in any way he can to keep me in bondage and to stop me from entering into a life of freedom that Jesus offers me. Peter wrote that he in fact stalks around like a roaring lion seeking whom he can devour. The enemy is engaged in a battle for my mind. So how can we resist him? How can we fight him off? Many people have suggested lots of different ways. For example, I've heard people saying, "You just declare scripture and you gain freedom." Now, I can understand that to a certain extent. You see, the idea behind it is that by declaring the truth, you eventually come to the point of believing it. But Paul, when speaking in Romans 5:10, verse 9, says this, that if you confess with your mouth, in other words, declare the Lord Jesus, and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. We could equally say, if you declare with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be freed. Declaration is a tool, but it's only a tool to help us believe. It's not the final solution. I'd like to encourage you, if you declare something, declare it with the intention of seeking to believe it. It is that that actually will help you win the battle. Appropriating the benefits of the salvation is a matter of confessing and believing. In the list of weapons that Paul gives us in Ephesians 6, he includes the helmet of salvation. In fact, in the Passion Translation, it says, "Embrace the power of salvation's full deliverance, like a helmet to guide your thoughts from lies." We seem to be able to readily accept our salvation. We're to use that salvation as an aid to help us combat the lies of the enemy. The battle has actually been won. Jesus has done it all. My salvation is a potent weapon that I can use against the lie that I'm not free. I cannot improve on what Jesus accomplished for me when he died. And in fact, the devil will actually come along time and time again and try to point out to me that I'm struggling, that I'm actually failing, that I'm yearning to be free, and the enemy will point to my failures. But when you turn to Jesus, the Saviour points to his triumph. It's not so about us and what we do. It's about us trusting in what he has done. A number of times in the writings of the apostles, we are encouraged to focus on the completed work of Jesus and to change our way of thinking. It's alien for us to think this way, but it's God's way of thinking. By doing so, we become fully equipped to stand and combat against the devil. It is a question of me bringing my thinking into line with what Jesus declares about me. 2 weeks ago, when leading our worship, Nikki Haley sang these words, "I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. I am who you say I am." When she sang those words, my heart leapt, quite simply because I knew that I was going to be sharing these thoughts with you this morning. You see, my confidence can only be in what Jesus says about me. I can have no confidence in myself, but I can have confidence in him. And that may be hard at times, but nevertheless, Jesus will keep my mind. With my confidence on the triumph of Jesus and my mind stayed on his promises to me, I am equipped to take on any of the lies that the enemy throws at me. When considering my freedom, Jesus felt it was worth fighting for. How can I not completely trust him? How can I not completely yield myself to him? The Bible encourages us to present our lives as living sacrifices before God. Now, as far as I can see, a sacrifice doesn't do an awful lot. It just literally lays down and dies and waits for the flames to consume it. In a sense, when we come to Jesus, We are saying to him, Lord, I'm laying my life down to you. I'm surrendering my life to you. In the same way, when we are talking about issues like freedom, when we're talking about issues like a miraculous lifestyle, I believe that part of the answer is in us laying down our understanding and saying to him, Lord, I surrender, I sacrifice everything to your way of doing things. And from there, moving on and growing in confidence in him. That is equal to all his other blessings. You see, I believe that these promises are yes and amen. I may struggle with them, but nevertheless, I believe he meant them. If Jesus said something, if he promised it, I believe he meant it. He didn't waste words. He just used his words wisely to convey the message of hope, the message of joy, the message of victory that he wanted us to have. Paul was a man who was often criticized and often taken, his ministry was often criticized by other people. Once in speaking in defense of his ministry, he used these words, which I believe we can use in the face of the lies that the enemy would seek to sow in our lives, the distrust, the doubt that he would seek to put there. You'll find them in 2 Corinthians verse 10, chapter 10, verse 5 to 6. I'm going to read to you from the Passion Translation. Listen to this. We can demolish every deceptive fantasy that opposes God and break through every arrogant attitude that is raised up in defiance of the true knowledge of God. We capture like prisoners of war every thought and insist that it bows in obedience to the Anointed One. Since we are armed with such dynamic weaponry, we stand ready to punish any trace of rebellion as soon as you choose to complete obedience. It is in complete obedience, complete trust, complete sacrifice, complete belief that we will know victory. May the Lord bless you.
Yeah, thank you, Alan, for that great reminder that we have an identity in Jesus, and along with that, an authority to go and do the works that Jesus did. That none of us is excluded, that we all have been equipped and commissioned to do the works of Jesus. But a very important thing to remember in that is not only are we called and equipped, but we don't have to understand everything in order to go and do it. We just have to lay down our lives, as Alan said, and trust in him. Lay everything before him, even the right to have to understand everything. We're always trying to understand things, you know, and we often will disqualify us from receiving a blessing because we can't understand it, whereas we're not meant to understand it, we're meant to just receive it. And so I really just want to draw your attention to something on the back of what Alan has said that has gone on during this last week. As you know, there was the George Floyd, the killing, and that caused an eruption of reaction, and some people protested, and some of those protests led on into violence, because some people have an agenda that's much more than just wanting to protest. They want to overthrow the system, they want to challenge everything. And then from that, there was this situation that's arisen in a couple of cities in America, or maybe more, where they've set up a zone where the police have withdrawn, and they've just set up this zone where they say this is like almost like a state within a state. And the most notorious of those was in Seattle, called first it was called Chaz, and then it was called Chop City, Chaz City or Chop City. But I just want to say to you, because you may not have followed that news, that some bad stuff happened in those places. It wasn't the peaceful and peace-loving place that it's claimed to be. Some bad things happened, but one of the best things that's happened, and that's an example of a representation of some of the best things that have happened, which probably won't appear in the news, is that believers have been going in there, and there was a group that a guy called Charlie Shamp was part of that went in there, and people from around the States, they weren't locals, and Charlie Shamp has actually preached in our building at King's Heart, and is known to some of you, follow him, he's got a prophetic gifting and so on, but he went in with a number of others into this no-go area, this independent zone, and they experienced an incredible atmosphere of darkness in this place, an incredible number of broken people. But they went with the determination to share the love of Jesus. They went to do the very things that Alan's been talking to us about this morning, to expect and believe that God would work through them and operate through them supernaturally. And so they moved into this place, and they saw miracles, they saw God give them favour, they saw breakthroughs in, you know, even some highly placed people, they were given favour. They were regarded with suspicion at first. People kept thinking they must be undercover cops or something. But anyway, they had a breakthrough, and they had tremendous miracles happen. And so I just want to leave you, I can't go into the detail of that. It's all there on YouTube if you do a search for it. But they said this is where the kingdom was on display, in the midst of real mess, in the midst of real risk and real violent atmosphere, and the potential for violence right there all the time. And yet they saw God move, and they saw God's love touching people, and they saw people weeping and broken, giving their lives to Jesus, and they saw people healed. And I believe that this is what God's calling us to. So I just want, I felt I had to say this at the end today, following Alan's talk, because I just want to reinforce it and say this is a living thing, this is a living reality, this isn't just theory. This isn't just theology. This isn't just doctrine. Some people are actually doing it. And their encouragement at the end of that, as they give the testimonies, to say, come on, guys, you can do this too. Don't beat yourself up if you don't see the same dramatic results as we did, but just go out there trusting in him. You know, you can make a difference. You can make a difference. One of the stories, just to say, it's not just about young people either. They told one of the stories they told, but as of meeting a lady who'd come to be seen as, they called her Mama, because she'd gone there again to display and demonstrate the love of God. And the thing that hit her from the cry of this man who's been killed by the police officer there, his actions, was when he cried out for his mum. And she thought, these people need spiritual mothers, fathers, they need people to go amongst them and do that. And she went in Jesus' name again, to be a spiritual mum, to be a mum to those people. And they gave her pride a place right near the centre where everything was happening. Even though she openly said, I'm here, you know, in the name of Jesus, and I want to bless you and love you and show you his love. So I leave you with those thoughts and with a kind of a challenge on top of what Alan said, to reinforce what Alan said, really, not to replace it, because these testimonies are real. These things are really happening. These things can really happen in your experience. We touched a little bit in Heart and Soul, but and some of the street pastors who go out even now in the streets in Romford are seeing that in our town. But there's more to come. There's more to come. As we lay our lives down and just go out in His name, I believe, you will see these things. You will see these things happen. Just before we go, I need to just remind you again, remind you about the Zoom meeting that you can join in with after this meeting. Have a great week and God bless you all. May you just see the hand of God at work in your life. I know that we've all tasted in part, but let's press in for the full meal. Let's not just have the starters. Let's go for the full meal this week. Whatever that means for you, ask the Holy Spirit what it might mean for you. Ask Him. He wants to tell you. He doesn't want to keep it secret. And He's interested in you in particular. Not just in what the leaders are doing, not just in what famous people from around the world are doing, you know, become famous in the Christian world. Not just those people. He's certainly not just with the politicians and the newsmakers. He's interested in you. And He wants to do something through you. So be blessed this week. Feast on Him. And just see what He does. See what He does, because He wants to use you, and He wants to give you encouragement this week as you step out in His name, because He wants to show you stuff. And there's no more pleasure you'll find than seeing you've stepped out and you've seen God work in your life, and you've seen something change because you stepped out in His name. So bless you all. Have a great, great week. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell that you're pleased and that I am never alone. 'Cause you're a good, good Father. That's who you are. That's who you are. That's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. For answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we can say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways to love.
you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. You're perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Let's sing that again.
You're perfect in all of your ways.
Sing it to him.
You're perfect in all of. You're perfect in all of your way to